rose. Those walls are rubble now. Remember those giants we call death and grave. They were like mountains that stood in our way. But he came and he died and he rose. Those giants are dead now. This is our God. This is who he is. He loves us. This is our God. This is what he does. He saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus. Remember that fear that took our breath away. Fear so weak that we could barely pray. But he heard every word, every whisper. Those altars in the wilderness tell the story of his faithfulness. Never once did he fail, and he never will. This is our God, this is who he is. He loves us. This is our God, this is what he does. He saves. Nobody but Jesus. Who pulled me out of that pit? He did, he did. Who paid for all of our sin? Nobody but Jesus. Who rescued me from that grave? Yahweh, Yahweh. Who gets the glory and praise? Nobody but Jesus. Who rescued me from that grave? Yahweh, Yahweh, who gets the glory and praise? Nobody but him. This is our God. This is who he is. He loves us. This is our God. This is what he does. He saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus.
I love that song. Thanks for playing. That's been on my repeat on my playlist for weeks since it's come out. So, hey, before you sit down, turn around, tell somebody who you got in the game today, and then go ahead and take a seat. All right, we're going to give you a chance to show a little team. Who? Let's hear from the people that are 49ers fans. You know, there were a few more than I anticipated. Okay, now let's hear from the Chiefs fans. All right. Now let's hear from those people who just don't give a rip. All right. We got Dan. We got Mr. Drummer up here. I guess you're a Chiefs fan.
Let's go, Blue!
As you guys might see, Tom is away today, so we're a little crazy, all right? So that's all right. As a matter of fact, I'm just going to say this. His book just killed mine, so I've dumped mine down to $5 today. Go on in there and do whatever you want, okay? go. All right, sounds good. So if you're visiting with us today, we're sorry for this first part of the service, all right? But we'd love for you to stop by either the information desk, or there's a room right across the hallway called the Connect Room. You can go in there. They'll give you a packet on the church, answer any questions you might have, show you around, and they'll also hook you up with a t-shirt for you and anybody else that's with you today. And then we've got a few announcements this morning. So check your bulletin. They're always in there, but just to highlight a couple things. One, we've got an Explore Oak Bridge service. So again, if you're new to the church, maybe you've been going here for a while, but you just wonder why we do what we do, how we started, where we're going, all those kind of things. We've got a luncheon for you. Again, I think the dates are in the bulletin, but you can check that out coming up at the end of the month and after the second service, and that'll go for like an hour, hour and 15 minutes, answer questions and just get acquainted with the church. So we've got a baptism service coming up on March the 3rd. We've already got 12 people signed up for that. So yeah. So again, I would encourage you, if you've made the decision that Jesus is who he says he is, and that he will fulfill every promise that he's ever been made, you believe that he rose from the dead, then your next step is to be baptized. And so if you haven't done that, then I would encourage you to sign up for that. I'll send some stuff out to you, give you a call, and then we can go with that. Then I've also got, not this Wednesday, it's Valentine's Day this Wednesday, guys, remember that. But this Wednesday, not this one, but the following Wednesday, I've got a 3-week class starting on the Holy Spirit. Because again, I think there's a lot of misunderstandings about the Holy Spirit, but even more than that, and Josh is going to reference a little bit in his message, but I think we tend to live below where we could be living because we squelch the work of the Spirit in us. So if you've got questions about the Holy Spirit, how we can live in the power of the Holy Spirit, stay in step with that 3-week class starting on the 21st. And then there's going to be a class coming up, more in your bulletin, and you can check things out. But a class coming up on the resurrection, a 1-week class that Tim Weber is going to be doing. We'll have signups for that out soon. But there's a sheet out at the information desk that's got all the calendar of upcoming events. If you notice, we stuck in there the Married Life Lives coming, all those kind of things. But you can get this sheet out there and check out what's coming. So I'm going to go ahead and say a prayer, and then we are going to continue worshiping. Father in heaven, just you're an amazing God, a good God. That's who you are. You love us, and you came and you save us. And Father, Jesus came so that we could have abundant life. In spite of circumstances, in spite of what might be going on around us, we have the peace that passes understanding because Jesus is arose, our King. We thank you for that. May our praise and worship be honoring. May we be people that are excited for things in our lives like Super Bowls, but way more excited about singing back songs to you, glory and praise that you only deserve. So, Father, I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand up and sing.
There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another. Across the bears of is and we'll be through it all. So come what may, in the space between all the things unseen and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. Be another in the fire.
I'm going to have you sit down one more time and then be getting back up again in a little bit. But we're going to take communion together right now. And, you know, we've sang songs that says that our God loves us, our God saves us. We just sang that song that referenced an Old Testament passage where God actually came down. And I think it was Jesus in the Old Testament where he was in the fire with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego with the promise that he's never going to leave us, that he's with us no matter what we go through. And those are all truths, and we need to be reminded of those over and over again. And we can look back at communion and think of what Christ has done on our behalf on the cross and the body that he gave up for us and the blood that he shed, and we can be assured of those things and remember that. But, you know, in Scripture, it talks about that we have a response to those things. As a matter of fact, in the book of 1 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul's writing to a church, and this church was kind of jacked up sometimes. They did some things that were kind of wacky. And as a matter of fact, they would come together for a meal, for the Lord's Supper, to remember what Christ has done on our behalf. And it was probably a much bigger meal than, you know, little emblems. But people would get there early, and they would start eating before everyone had arrived. They were getting drunk at this meal, this meal in remembrance of what Christ had done. And so this whole thing was causing disunity within that church. The one thing that should have brought everybody together, the remembrance of what Christ has done for us, was causing chaos. And Paul says, this can't be. He says, look, you follow Jesus. I mean, how can you remember what he did for us? How can you proclaim that he's coming back and that he actually rose from the dead and yet do the things that you're doing? It's not compatible. Paul says, before you take of communion, he says, I want you to examine yourselves. How's your life going? What's your response to this message? How's your response to the sacrifice of Jesus Christ? Because you should be living a life that's moving in his direction, that echoes, that promotes the values, the good news of Jesus Christ. And as a matter of fact, Paul goes on and he says, you know what? God's not pleased with this. He says, there are even people, and I don't know how all this works, and he says, but there are even people in our midst back in that day who were sick and even dying because of the irreverence that they're showing to God. So, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ this morning, I would invite you to remember and to partake with us, but I want us all to take some time. What's your response? How's life going? What are your priorities? You know, Scripture says that we really believe this. We become a slave to God. We give up our lives for this message, for this cause, for this person. But yet in doing so, we gain so much more. We gain everything. So take some time. Examine your hearts. Confess your sins. Ask for forgiveness and remember what Jesus Christ has done on our behalf. So take some time on your own and then I'll lead us. y'all would, you can go ahead and take the bread and go ahead and eat it and remember that this was the body of Christ given up for us. And then you could take the juice and go ahead and drink and remember that that was the shed blood of Jesus Christ that ushered in the new covenant. Father in heaven, I pray that you give us a passion. You give us a desire to serve, to love, to be light and salt, to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, because we have been changed. We have been given so much more. We have every spiritual blessing in Christ. So Father, that's not something that you ever intended for us to keep to ourselves. Help us to live lives that are worthy of the call. But Father, we thank you because we know that we fall short often. We forget, our priorities get messed up, and we thank you for grace. It says, turn around, come back, and you're a Father with open arms. But you love us too much to keep us where we're at. We thank you for the Holy Spirit conviction and change in us, Father. So help us just to live our lives in step with your Spirit who is alive in us. It's in the mighty name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Let's stand up and sing.
Have you ever been in a space like this as a worshiper, as a believer in Jesus, reading lyrics, listening to a song that you believe, and realize in the middle of it that you're not singing? Have you ever been there? Like, there are times where I'm in the presence of the people of God, the presence of God Himself, whether that be in a car, or church service, whatever it may be, and listening to earth-shattering, life-changing lyrics that have drastically impacted my life, and I realize, man, I'm just like listening. I'm not really engaged. I'm not really praising. I think there's something to that. You see over and over again in the Psalms where the psalmist would preach to himself to sing, to shout to God, to praise God. It's almost like his soul, his mind, his heart needed to be reminded to sing. And we sing because these are true songs. These are true songs. We're really loved by God. He really is our Savior, our Father, our friend, and we can experience that love. We can commune with our Father. We can experience the power of a Savior today. If I'm not careful, I begin to believe that these things are set aside for me in a far-off place, in a far-off time that has not been ushered in yet. And that is not true. While I long for the day when Jesus Christ returns and these things will be experienced in full, I can experience them now. When I believed in Jesus as Lord and Savior, I was ushered in from darkness to light, from death to life. I was given victory in that moment. And we can walk in it now. We can walk in it now. This isn't a love that we'll just experience one day. This isn't a friendship or a relationship with our Father that we'll experience one day. This isn't just a Savior where we'll see His power at work one day. We can experience it now. And so I don't know who needs to be reminded. I don't know whose soul needs to be encouraged to sing, but I'm going to say it. Sing. Sing. We're going to give you another minute and a half to sing, to shout, to get excited about the love of God that's for you both now and forever. Let's sing together.
Hallelujah, we are not alone. Is God really?
Y'all can be seated. I really do believe that the power of God can make a difference in our lives today, that we could be changed, that we could be impacted. And I think this passage that we're about to read and hopefully unpack gives us somewhat of a blueprint on how to experience this on a day-to-day basis. Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 through 31, context will be provided throughout. That night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. That first sentence is, that's for another time, friends, that's for another time. Descriptive, not prescriptive. Don't get any ideas. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" And he answered, "Jacob." Then the man said, your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you've struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. All right, just going to pray that God would use that in our lives this morning. Raise your hand if you've ever injured yourself to the point where you walked with a significant limp. Raise your hand. Okay, all right. Yeah, I have. And I actually got a text from a buddy a few weeks ago. And he's on my basketball team on Monday nights. We play in a men's league basketball team. It's a big deal. We're the Sonics. And he texted a few weeks ago and said he was maybe going to be out for a few weeks. He's hurting. And then he sent a picture, said, "I'm limping real bad. I can't really put any weight on it." And since then, he's gone to a surgeon. It's shattered in multiple places. It might be a career-ending injury. But anyways, we responded right away in our group text, "What happened to you? What happened," right? Like when someone has a limp, there's always kind of a question that goes along with it. Well, how'd you get it? And so he directs our attention to a video. He travels a lot. He's a wild man. He's a wild man. And so I knew it was going to be a story. He's always been a wild man. I went wayward a little bit in high school my senior year. And so he would always be at the parties. We'd chant his name and he'd roll down the stairs. That was just this thing, you know. And so wild man. So I knew there was going to be a story. And so he directs our attention to a video where he's on top of a mountain. He's on top of a mountain, and it literally looks like he's at the peak. I mean, the video is breathtakingly beautiful until it wasn't, right? And you knew he was way up high because it's peak snowboarding, skiing season, and nobody else is up there. Nobody else is up there with him, and so he has this idea to see how fast he can go down this massive steep slope, and he has a video that he's taking, and it wasn't but a few seconds before it sounds like he's on an airplane. He said he had some technology that told him how fast he was going. He was going 48 miles per hour within a few seconds, and then before you know it, he hits something, falls over, shatters his ankle. Big time blow for the Sonics. Big time blow for the Monday night Sonics. But it's a story. Story. Like if I saw you after service today and you were limping and if we had time to chat, I'd be like, "What happened? What happened?" Because a limp carries with it a story. And we just read a passage of scripture about a man named Jacob turned to Israel who walks with a limp, and perhaps it shares a story. In fact, perhaps this limp led Jacob to be able to share his story. Perhaps this limp points us to the greatest story of all time, so let's think about it together. In fact, we're going to start with a man named Abraham. In Genesis 1 through 11, humanity has made a mess of God's creation. They have sinned against God, shaken their fist at his authority, and ushered in this pattern of sin and death. The family has been corrupted. The institution has been corrupted. The theological belief about God is definitely corrupted, and it's a mess. And so what does God do? He starts by picking up the first piece of the mess, and he goes to Abraham and says, "I'm going to make a covenant with you, Abraham. I'm going to bring you to a place. I'm going to establish from your lineage a people, and I'm going to give you a blessing that's big enough to bless the whole wide world." But Abraham at the time And his wife, they were collecting Social Security. They were well past their prime, their childbearing years. And so they're like, this doesn't make any sense. And so 20 years go by and they have the promised son, Isaac. The promised son, Isaac. Isaac marries Rebecca, and Rebecca gives birth to two twin boys, pre-modern medicine. And so, go Rebecca. That's impressive. You know, childbirth. It's a thing, And I remember. This is besides the point, but I remember when we had our firstborn, we went to the first ultrasound, and I have a phobia of all things medical, just is what it is. And so I remember it's the first ultrasound, and I just, it was too much for me. And so I felt like I was going to pass out, and I told them, I'm like, I'm going to pass out. And they're like, you aren't doing anything. I'm like, I know, but it's so much, and it's intrusive. And so I had to go to the bathroom, and then I came back in the room, couldn't figure it out, and ended up dry heaving on the floor into a trash can in front of my wife and her doctor. And so that was a rough moment. And so I told her, I'm like, I'm not going to any more of these ultrasounds. It's too much for me. And it was during COVID, you know, and so I was like, I'm just going to stay home and protect everybody. I'm going to protect everybody. You know, might be asymptomatic. No, I'm kidding. All right, this is too much. And so I'm going to stay home. And so I didn't go to any of the ultrasounds, but then, you know, childbirth, and then second one came, didn't really go to any of those, but I couldn't skip out on the birth, you know? And so I was in the room, and so the second baby comes along, and I remember saying, hey, I'm not gonna make this about me, okay? And so I don't want to pass out. And so if I feel anything coming, I'm gonna go do my own thing, and God will be with you, and so will your mother, right? And so I remember it's almost showtime for baby number two. She's fully dilated. We're about to have a child. And again, stuff comes in. I'm like, this is a lot. And so I start feeling queasy. I go sit in the corner, put my head between my knees, and the doctor comes in, and the doctor's like, hey, where's your husband? This is about to happen. And she turns around, and she goes, oh, never mind. I remember him. It's a true story. I remember him. And it has nothing to do with the sermon, but that happened. And so Esau's born. He's the firstborn. And he's hairy and he's red. So he's named Esau. He grows up to be masculine. He's good with his hands. He's a skillful hunter. He's a manly man. Reminds me of myself. Kidding, joking. And then the second son is Jacob. And the scriptures say there was a battle in the womb. There was a battle in the womb, and when the babies came out, Jacob was holding on to the heel. He was grabbing onto the heel of Esau. And so when Rebecca named Jacob, she looks at him and she's like, this is my jacked up second child. Maybe you've had one before. And my crazy second born. And so she names him Jacob, which means supplanter, heel grabber, or deceiver. And like in those days, names were a big deal. It had to do with destiny and your future and your character, a lot different than today. And so you begin to see the contrast between Esau and Jacob. Jacob is kind of a mama's boy. He likes to be in the kitchen. He's a good cook. And so you see the contrast. And there none of which is more important than the fact that Esau is the firstborn. Jacob is not. What goes along with being the firstborn son in this time period is the bulk of the inheritance comes to him. The family lineage is carried out through him. The spiritual blessing given by the father is reserved for the firstborn son. So this is a big, big deal. And as they grow up, Jacob begins to live out and carry out his title or his name. You begin to see it. He begins to deceive and connive. And so there's one day Esau's out in the field. He's hungry. He's working the grounds. He comes back in. It says he's famished. He's also very dramatic. And he says, Jacob, I'm so hungry. I'm famished. I need that soup you make. You're a really good cook. I need you to make that soup. Otherwise, I'm going to die, right? To which I'm like, you're in the kitchen, man. Just grab something, right? But he's like, Jacob, make me the soup. And Jacob's really good. He's a deceiver. He does it on the spot. And he says, I'll give you the soup if you give me your birthright in exchange. What comes along with the birthright is the family inheritance, a bunch of wealth, a bunch of different things tied up to it. And so Esau trades his birthright for a bowl of soup. A lot of probably good lessons from that story, but we'll just say this. Jacob takes advantage of Esau for the birthright. And then years go by, and Isaac is now old in age. He can't really see. He's going blind. He is struggling a little bit. And so he's like, it's time. It's time. I better bless my firstborn son. And again, this blessing is weighty, spiritual. Some theologians say it's supernatural even. If you read the blessing, you're like, that seems weighty. And so Rebekah prefers Jacob, at least she seemingly does if you read the text. And so Rebekah goes to Jacob and is like, hey, Esau's out in the field. Isaac wants to bless Esau. Let's go in and steal Esau's blessing. And so they disguise him as Esau. I like to think Esau has a deep voice. And so Jacob comes in and he's like, Dad, I'm Esau. I need a blessing, right? And then Isaac's old. And so Isaac's like, ooh, okay, Esau, okay, yeah. I will give you the blessing. This is so stupid. Sorry, I don't know the voices. This is so silly. But again, try and go there with me. Isaac's like, yeah, you kind of seem like Jacob, but I trust that you're Esau. And so, you know, heaven's due will be yours. The fatness of the earth will be yours. Your brothers will serve you. And then he gives Jacob Esau's blessing. And again, powerful blessing. And then Esau comes in and is like, give me my blessing. And Isaac's like, I already gave you. He's like, no. And then he gives him, you know, he declares some stuff over him that's pretty jacked up. And you're like, Jacob, why'd you do that, man? Rebekah, why'd you do that? This is messed up. This is sad. So Jacob takes advantage of Isaac for the blessing, to which you read that and you're like, heel grabber, deceiver, supplanter, right? Like he's jacked up. And so then Esau despises the birthright and wants to kill his brother for stealing the blessing. You read the story, crazy story. And then Rebekah's like, Jacob, you need to leave. The covenant seems like it's kind of under threat now. This is dangerous. Like, I don't want to lose both of you. You need to leave. And so he goes and runs, and he meets a guy named Laban who has two daughters. Laban has two daughters, Rachel and Leah. Rachel is beautiful, very attractive, and he loves her and he wants to marry her. Jacob does. The scriptures say Leah is weak-eyed. The Bible did. And so if you look at it, it sure seems like the Bible's just saying she's just tougher to look at. It's the only time the Bible is politically correct ever, right? Like, she's weak-eyed. And so he's like, I want to marry Rachel. And the father is really just, anyways, it's like, you can marry Rachel, but you got to work for me 7 years. And so Jacob works 7 years, and then the wedding night comes, and Jacob wakes up in the morning. He's like, oh, what's up, girl? What's up, Rachel? He opens his eyes, and he's like, shoot, it's Leah, right? Like, he marries the wrong girl. And so he's tricked. True. Some things start catching up with him. You reap what you sow. The deceiver's been deceived. And you can make a case that Laban's actually just being a good dad, because security comes along with your daughters being married, different time period. And so anyways, he wants to make sure both of his daughters are good when he leaves. And so he's like, work another 7 years, I'll give you Rachel. He works another 7 years, gets Rachel, works another 5 or 6 years, been there almost 20 years. And then he realizes, okay, I need to go back home. I need to go back to the land that I was promised in Genesis 28, just 4 chapters earlier, while he's on the run. God meets with him and says, you will not be a foreigner forever. You will come back to the land that I've promised Abraham and Isaac and yourself, and your descendants will be as numerous as the sand on the seashore. And so this is beautiful promise. And so he needs to go home, but before he goes home, you see that he's still conniving and he's still tricking and he's still kind of lying to Laban, and he's up to his same old ways. But Laban kind of mistreats him. He convinces the daughters to leave with him, and they don't even say goodbye, and they peace out. They peace out. And Laban eventually catches up to him, and because God is faithful to the covenant, he sends word to Laban not to harm Jacob, and kind of a cool passage there. And then he's on the way home, but he knows that in order to go home, he's got to deal with Esau. He's got to deal with his past before the new start begins. And so he sends word to Esau, hey, I'm going to come home, but I haven't been on the run. I'm not going to harm you. In fact, I've just been, you know, kind of, we've had a family. And so he sends word, and then Esau sends word back. Esau is coming to see you with 400 men. Interpret that how you'd like, Jacob. And so again, Jacob remembers 20 years ago, Esau's wanting him dead. And so this is scary. This is a big deal. Jacob's like, what is going to happen? And so it's recorded in the same chapter of text that we just read. He sits down as he's preparing to go back home and he prays, O God of my father Abraham and the God of my father Isaac, O Lord, who said to me, return to your country and to your kindred that I may do you good. I'm not worthy of the least of all the deeds of steadfast love and all the faithfulness that you have shown to your servant. For with only my staff, I crossed this Jordan and now I have become two camps. Please deliver me from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him that he may come back and attack me, the mothers with the children. But you said, I will surely do you good and make your offspring as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude. Okay, so I got more written here, but I got to go fast because I'm having too much fun. I'm struggling to get through this. And so this is a good prayer. We'll just say that. It's a good prayer. It's a powerful prayer. He seems to have remorse, even though it's probably just because he knows he's afraid, but there's at least somewhat of remorse. He trusts the promises of God that were given to him in the past, and he's even honest about the fear that's going on in his heart and in his mind. So it's a good prayer. But then he continues to deceive. You see it. He begins to plot. He begins to try and control his own destiny and his own future. And so he tries to send a bunch of material wealth to Esau to kind of soften whatever might be coming. And so he sends him goats, bulls, camels, ewes. I didn't know what those were until a couple weeks ago during my sermon. We had a debate in the midst of the passage. Female sheep, right? Praise God. Cows, donkeys. And then he's like, hey, servant number one, go ahead and talk to Esau, soften him a little bit, give him all this stuff. And then he's like, servant number two, if he's really mad, you do the same thing. I'm going to stay back. And you're like, whoa, he's scheming again. Deceiving, running, afraid. And this is where God meets Jacob. And I love this about God. I'm Jacob. You know, this is Jacob. He's unsettled. He's a schemer. He's a conniver. He's a deceiver. And God meets him there. God does not wait until Jacob is changed to meet with him and have an encounter with him. It's the other way around, but I don't want to get ahead of myself. So let's just pause from the text for a moment. I don't know what you've been thinking. I don't know how good you are at running from God. I don't know the sin in your life. I don't know the patterns that continue to resurface in your life that are unhealthy. I don't know how long you've been living apart from the will of God and apart from passion for God and the things of God. I don't know, but what I do know is God can meet you there. God is the God of second chances. God is the God of countless second chances. God is the God who can meet with you and help you begin again. God is the God who longs to meet with people who are in places where they aren't even looking for him in. This is good news. And so maybe you're like, well, it's my kids. They're prodigals. Those are little heel grabbers and deceivers. Yeah, God can meet them there. Well, it's my spouse or one of my people that I love most, and they're going on a way that's, you know, not the way that God would have for them. Oh yeah, God can show them a new one and put them on a new one. Well, it's me. I've been struggling and running this way for a really long time. Yeah. God longs to maybe step into that mess and turn some things around. I'm convinced that churches, I'm convinced that people with microphones need to tell other people there is no valley too deep for God to reach down, scoop you up out of. There is no mountain too high for God to climb. There is no sin too dark for God to overcome. There is no pattern that you're so deep into that God can't overcome. This is our God. He meets with Jacob there. And so Jacob goes and sets his family up for the night, and he goes to be alone. And so he's alone, or at least so he thought he was alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. We believe this is an appearance of God. We believe this is a theophany in the Old Testament in the form of a man who wrestles. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Okay, couple observations. First, I believe that God picks the fight. I believe that God seeks Jacob out, picks the fight, picks the wrestling match. And I also believe that we have no reason to believe from this text that Jacob could actually put up a fight physically against the man who he's wrestling with. And I know that from the text where it says he just touches his hip and his hip is wrenched and he's walking with a limp for the rest of his life. And so it seems as if God is kind of graciously entertaining Jacob. It's like a parent who wrestles with their little kid. Any parents ever wrestle with their kids in here? Okay, yeah, three of us. Good, good, good. Yeah, awesome. Okay, good. Yeah, we'll do a parenting sermon next. So it's like, you know, if you wrestle with your kids, it's not like you're going to be like, hey, you want to wrestle? Boom, you're done, right? Like if you did that, you need help, you know? And so... So, you know, I wrestled with Josie this week, and it was fun. I entertained her, but you could snap her in half, right? Like that, right? And so this is God. This is God. And it seems like Jacob, spiritually and emotionally, though, is putting up a fight. He is wrestling with God until he's not. Then he just holds on. And the man said, let me go, for it's daybreak. But Jacob replied, I will not let you go unless you bless me. He's given up the fight. He's given up the hand-to-hand combat. I'm not going to defeat you, but I'm also not going to let go until you bless me. The man asked him, what's your name? Jacob, he answered. Then the man said, your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you've struggled with God and with humans and have overcome. Jacob says, tell me your name. God's like, nope. But I will bless you. And then he walks away with a limp, excited because he saw God face to face. So let's walk through this for a moment. God shows up. Why? Why? To which I'll say, I'm not exactly sure. But perhaps a lot of reasons, but I believe there is one reason that kind of comes to the forefront as you think about and study this passage. You see, God has made a promise to Jacob. God has made a promise to Jacob's father and his grandfather. This is the land in which you will dwell, and he's been a foreigner for 20 years, and he wants to go back there. Jacob is worried about getting places. Jacob is worried about going home. Jacob believes this is the will of God for his life, and it is. And it is. I can't live out here forever, but before God sends Jacob back there, Jacob needs to be changed, and that's important. The running, the lying, the conniving, the deceiving, that's got to be changed. Hey, Jacob, you're worried about the external circumstances. I'm worried about the internal things in your heart. Is that relevant for anybody? Has that ever been you? You're so focused and fixated on the external circumstances in your life that you forsake the internal and what's going on in your heart and your mind and your soul? Hey, God, give me that new job. Give me to that new place. Well, son or daughter, how about you just get content for one time in your life where you're at? Hey, God, bring me a husband or a wife. Well, you need to get rid of the envy now. You need to get rid of the lust now. We need to take some things out of your life before we usher some things into it. Hey, God, I need more money. Well, you're greedy with what you got now. Hey, God, bring me this thing. Well, before I bring you to this thing or that place, I need to reach into your heart, your soul, your mind, and get some things out of your life first. Because if I don't, you're going to get there and you're going to bring the same old you and the same old sin and the same old patterns and the same old junk. And before you know it, you're going to be back in the same old place saying, God, get me somewhere else. And so I think from this passage, you see that God cares about your character. God cares about your character. While we often look at the outward things, God looks at the heart. And I think we get a picture of how God changes us from the inside out from this text. One is repentance. Good old-fashioned repentance, the good old church word, repentance that we should say more often. This is what Jesus leads off with. Repent, turn to God, the kingdom of God is now at hand. Repent. just means to change your mind. It just means to turn around. I'm not going to keep thinking this. I'm not going to keep going here. I'm not going to keep living this way. I'm not going to keep operating this way. I'm going to turn around. I'm going to get rid of some things. And you know, this all happens around the Jabbok River. The Jabbok River, and you can look this up on Google. The word Jabbok in Hebrew means emptying. And perhaps that's just a coincidence, but I think there's a message there for the sake of the sermon that maybe, just maybe, before God can fill you with the things that you long for, you need to empty yourselves of some things that are old. Some old ways of thinking, some old ways of living, perhaps some old relationships. You need to repent. You need to turn from this. But how many of you guys know that repentance is probably more about what you turn to than it is what you turn from? We've probably all been there. You've turned from something, thought you overcame it, all the while you turned to something that wasn't big enough and strong enough to sustain the life change and satisfaction that you longed for most. And so it seems like Jacob, at least to some extent, turns towards God. The second thing we need to do is to admit our issues. We need to admit our issues. And we all got them. We all got them. Sometimes I share them from a microphone. In fact, those are always the most well-received sermons. Hey, Josh, thanks for sharing that. I'm so glad you're jacked up, man. I'm so glad you got some marriage stuff. So glad you got some sin. So glad you got some irresponsibilities. So glad you struggle sometimes to be a good friend. So glad. So glad you're jacked up. And the reason that people like that is because we come into spaces like this and convince ourselves there's like this hierarchy of Christianity, and it's like those people got it all together, and we don't. And so we learn the language and the lingo, and we learn enough of the motions to go through on Sunday, where we go through and we're good, life's good, we're blessed and highly favored, and then we wonder why there's no power on Monday. It's fascinating, isn't it? We're more afraid of what would come about in our lives if we confessed our junk to God and to man than we are of where these sinful patterns and different things in our lives will lead us. And that's foolishness. And so God says, what's your name? God knows his name. God created him. He's son of Isaac, grandson of Abraham. He knows him. But he gives Jacob an opportunity to confess, I'm Jacob, I'm a deceiver. I stole from my brother. I connived with my mama. I took advantage of my dad. I deceived Laban. I've done this over and over and over and over again. This is who I am. This is what I've done. Freedom begins with admitting you need it. I'm jacked up. And I'm convinced that many of us are positionally free in Christ. We've been freed from sin, the condemnation of all of that. But in regards to practicalities and how we live as if at times we're still in chains. And so perhaps, maybe it even goes beyond that, freedom begins with desiring it enough to admit you need it. You know, I always find it interesting where Jesus is like, do you want to be healed? Do you want to be healed? There's some extent of like, do you long for this? What would it look like if we were a church in 2024, and I know it's February, but it still kind of feels like the new year, where we said, hey God, I want to be changed this year. I want to be molded this year. I want you to make me more like you this year. I don't want just like a Sunday morning faith where I prayed a prayer one time and I'm pretty sure I'm going to heaven one day. I want to be changed and impacted and molded now and tomorrow and the next day and the next day. What would that look like? I think some powerful things would begin to transpire in our world. And then we see the next thing is we just need to hold on to God. We need to hold on to God. And I love that God gives us the option not to, right? Have you ever felt like that where it's like, man, I have a choice to rebel. I have a choice to go in a direction that I know I'm not supposed to go to. He gives us that option. We aren't robots. But he also gives us the option to cling. And this is kind of what you see in the story. Hey, Jacob, let me go. Jacob's like, no. I will not defeat you. I cannot defeat you. I don't want a blessing by deceitful means anymore. I am going to hold on to you until you blessed me. There is an encounter strong enough for him to believe this is the God of my father and my grandfather, and so I'm going to cling to you. It reminds me of John chapter 6 when Jesus gives a tough teaching. A bunch of people leave. He looks at his friends. He's like, you going to leave too? And Simon Peter goes, leave? You have the words of eternal life. I've come to believe and know that you're the Holy One of God. In other words, where else am I going to go? No, I'm going to cling. I'm going to cleave. I'm going to hold on to you. And as we hold on to God, we're going to choose to believe what he says about us. He says, what's your name? The man says, Jacob. He goes, not anymore. Your name is Israel. Because you've wrestled with God, man, you've overcome. The word Israel means one who prevails with God. And there's some debate on the exact definition of this word, but I think the vast majority of theologians believe this is a title of victory. This is a title of victory. He was living in deceit and sin and defeat to some extent, a foreigner from the promise, and now I've changed your name. Hey, Jacob, you are no longer what your mama named you. You are no longer what your mom declared over you. Again, when we name our kids now, we're like, what sounds cute with our last name? In the Old Testament, this had to do with destiny, with future, with character. And Rebecca seems to tie Jacob's whole life to a moment. And God in this moment says, not anymore. You're not defined by that anymore. I am changing your name. And this is what he does, isn't it? From Abram to Abraham, which means father of many nations. From Sarai to Sarah, which means princess, I believe. From Simon to Peter, which means rock. If you follow along in the story of the gospel, Simon doesn't seem like a rock. And I think that's the point. Yeah, I do not define you by your performance in the past. I speak into your potential and I declare over you what I choose to declare over you. So Peter, you're a rock. And upon this confession of faith, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. He has been true on that promise. When we speak of Peter, we don't talk about Simon, do we? We call him Peter. God changed his name, changed his future. Put him on a new course over and over and over and over again. And we see that this is not reserved for a few cool characters in the Bible. This isn't confined to the Old Testament characters, the New Testament characters for that matter. If you're a believer in Jesus, God's changed your name. You were an orphan, now you're a kid. You're a son, you're a daughter. You're a child of the Most High God. You were in defeat. Now you have been hidden in Christ, seated with him in heavenly places. The old you was crucified with Christ, and now Christ lives in you. You've been given a new name. You're the light of the world. You're his workmanship. You're his ambassadors. He makes his appeal through you to the world. Be reconciled to God. This is who we are. This is what we've done. You are not your sin. You are not your past. You are not what people have declared over you, and you are not what you have come to believe about yourself. You are what God says about you. Why? He's God and you're not. Get over yourself. Trust him. Trust him. And then we see as we hold on to God and believe what he says about us, we'll begin to walk in it. We'll begin to walk in it. And I love just the little part in the text where it says, Israel walks away with a limp. Again, maybe we're just reading our New Covenant theology into this story, but he's not running anymore. He's not running anymore. He's not scheming anymore. He's not heel grabbing anymore. He's not deceiving his way into blessings anymore. In fact, we see Jacob, of all people, show up in the Faith Hall of Fame in Hebrews chapter 11. The heroes of the Faith Hall of Fame, we see his name in that passage. And this is what it says. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons. Used to steal blessings, now he's a blessing giver. And worshiped God as he leaned on the top of his staff. Perhaps because he was injured from the moment God changed his life. We desire more than a name change, don't we? We desire life change. And we serve the God of the name change and the life change. This is available to you. This is available to me in the power of God, in the power of God that we can experience on a day in, day out basis. And as we hold on to God, we're going to see his character peeled back one layer at a time. Right? I find it interesting in this passage, Jacob knew he was God, but he didn't have his name. And we see God reveals his name personally for the first time in Exodus to Moses. But he's like, hey, what's your name? God's like, don't worry about that. I'm going to answer your question with an action. I'm the God who gives you a new name, blesses you, and ushers you into a new future and destiny. And so you don't need to know everything about God today to trust God as Lord and Savior. You don't. And if you wait till you have all the answers about every facet of the character of God, you're in trouble. We can't fit him in our little box. But as we're learning and as we're growing, we can at least acknowledge we know a lot more than Jacob did, don't we? We have a lot more revelation than that old covenant saint. We do. We know that our God is Yahweh, Creator God, God of the covenant, who's faithful to keep his promises. He walks with his people through thick and thin. He loves us unconditionally. He tabernacled among us. He dwelt among us to prove to us that he loves us, to let us know who God is and what he looks like. All the fullness of the deity rests in Jesus in bodily form. Oh, we get to know him. We get to know about him. He's the God who died and rose from the dead, revealed himself to hundreds of people, has changed billions of people's destinies and lives here and now throughout the ages. This is who our God is. I'm grateful for him. But what's interesting is that even to the disciples who he revealed himself to after he had died and rose from the dead, do you know how some of his disciples realized it was him? Some theologians believe that Jesus looked much different after he rose from the dead. Some people didn't recognize him. I don't know about all that. I can't pretend to know that for sure. But I do know that some of his disciples are like, let me see the scars. Scars. And so from this, even from the fact that he has scars, we can begin to believe that not only do we see an appearance of God in the Old Testament, we see a foreshadowing of what God is like and what he came to do. We believe that Jesus is the greater Jacob. He wrestles with God in a garden. He is bruised and beaten and battered and broken so that we can be reconciled to God both now and forever. And after he accomplishes this, the crucified and risen Savior of the world goes, here they are. Here are the scars. Why? Scars tell a story. The scars are telling a story. I was dead, but now I'm alive. I was dead, but now I'm alive. Something extraordinary happened. The event that changed history took place. This is my story. I am the crucified and risen Christ. Perhaps you got some scars. Perhaps today you walk with some limps. Good news. They tell a story about the God who met you there, changed you there, set you on a brand new course, gave you a future and a destiny, and is working on your character both here and now. And if he's done it for you, he can do it for them. And so may we understand that along with the limp comes a story. The question is, are we willing to share it? Father, we love you. We're grateful for you, for your hope, for your love, for your character, for your nature, for the fact that you give us the opportunity today, maybe for the first time, maybe for the thousandth time, to repent of our sins, of some old ways of thinking, old ways of living, old patterns of behavior. God, may you give us the courage to do so, and may you help us turn towards you. Help us admit our weakness. Help us admit our junk. Help us empty ourselves so that we can be filled with your Spirit. And God, help us trust that as we hold on to you, as we cling to you as our only hope, you will reveal to us who you are and who we are, and we'll begin to live out the life that you have created for us to live. Help us trust you today. Help us see you more clearly today. Help us be changed today into the image of Jesus, the name above all names. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Let's stand and let's sing this song. Hope you're encouraged today. Hope you were lifted up, maybe challenged, encouraged, convicted in areas you need to be those things. And it's good to be here. It's fun. I don't know a lot of you. I should have probably introduced myself. My name's Josh, and don't know many of you. Yeah. And it's fun. That's a good thing. That means that people are being reached and lives are being impacted and families are being changed, and it's an exciting thing just to see and be a part of. And so I just encourage you to keep coming, to keep inviting, keep telling people, hey, come and see what this whole Jesus thing is about. We believe that the local church, when working right, is the hope of the world, not because Oak Ridge is amazing or not because, you know, anything even really that goes on up here. It's just we carry the message of Jesus that nobody else carries to a world that desperately needs it. And so, look, we aren't perfect, but I know when you come here, you're going to hear about the greatest story ever told that has the power to impact and change lives. And so keep coming, keep serving, keep giving, keep investing. I promise you, it is worth it. It's exciting. And so we'll be back next week, same time, same place. Bring somebody with you. We love you. Have a great Super Bowl Sunday.